Checkout Tracking by the NPD Group brings you a receipt collecting system that gathers data anonymously through technology we created, providing your businesses with answers.
So I have a question for everyone. Who's familiar with second price auction? Raise your hands. Mostly our clients, as I see. All right, so let me give you an example. See, you have an application and you want to display an advertisement within your application. You have two advertisers placing bids on your inventory. One places a bid of $10. Another one places a bid of $2. Question, who wins? Come on, guys, it's pretty straightforward.
$10.
All right, that's pretty straightforward. They place higher bid, they win. All right, the next question is, how much they pay? How much you as a publisher get paid?
$3,
$2.01. Any other versions? So the right answer is $2.01. That's the nature of second price auction. That seems to be quite unfair, right? Because if advertiser is ready to pay $10, if they want to pay dollars, if that is profitable for an advertiser, why don't we let them do it? So this is how the whole market operates nowadays. The whole market is built in favor of advertisers. And I started my company trying to bring back the balance to the marketplace, make it more efficient, and protect publishers' interests on this market. So today I will be telling you tricks and ideas how to mitigate second price auction and how to squeeze high revenues from ad networks. So, in order to mitigate a second price auction, we will be using a decoy or a shill. Basically, we introduce a third party in the auction that places a bid very close to the highest bid. So in this case, $9. So as a result, what happens next, advertiser pays not $2.01, but $9.01. Which is exactly what we want to let him do. We want to let him pay as much as he wants. So this is just one of the examples of what I will be talking about today. Let me give you a little bit of my background. So as was mentioned before, in 2011, I founded a company called Alpha Productions. Over several years, we published over 3,000 apps on Google Play and App Store. Currently, we have 4.5 million daily active users, and we primarily monetize on advertising. As any large publisher, we started creating an in-house solution that helped us to monetize more efficiently, to distribute traffic more efficiently, and to pull higher revenues from ad networks. I'm pretty sure that if you guys deal with a significant amount of traffic, you are familiar with the process of creating similar solution. So this is one of our apps, Piano Tiles, pretty popular. It has a lot of international traffic, and we always place tests using this application. So as you can see, in October last year, we made a complete transition from one of the mediation platforms to our in-house solution. And on this slide, you can see the way ratio between revenues and impressions has changed. So the amount of impressions blue on this slide remains about the same, but revenue actually went up to almost 3 times, 270%. So here is another example. This app is, I'm pretty sure you're familiar with this app because it's been trending on App Store for many years. And I think it is one of the largest downloaders. So iDownloader was one of our first customers when we announced Apple Deal, when we made it public and available for everyone. And so in this slide basically represents their eCPM growth. So overall, the iDownloader is hosting about 20 million impressions a day. So eCPM grew by 20 cents in this example, and it resulted in a significant growth of their revenue. So, all right, I mentioned how to mitigate second price auction. Basically, Apodil, my company, implements a decoy for the marketplace, and it is available for everyone to use. My company, we are mostly engineers, right? We don't have any marketing person, so it's all about technology. I'm not going to be giving you marketing details anymore. I will be going deeper into the technology and telling you what else can be done to monetize more efficiently. So, is anyone familiar with spacing here? Raise your hands. Like, when you buy advertisements on the ad network, you probably want to limit your daily budget. You don't want to spend too much. You want to spend like $1,000 a day, for instance. So that's called pacing. Why it is important as a publisher to know what pacing is and how it can affect your earnings. So first of all, it's important to remember that mobile apps don't play the same rules as mobile web or desktop web. In this specific example, it is important to remember that when user launches an app, there is no need to display advertisement right away. There is a slight delay before advertisement actually gets displayed, right? They launch an app, they tap here and there, they complete a level. You have a minute or two to find the appropriate ad network, to appropriate advertiser. Now, what happens when you try to display advertisement immediately without any delay? Sometimes your users just don't match higher paying advertisers paying pacing. I'm sorry. So because advertisers put their campaign temporarily on hold automatically, and your users just don't match it, and so you have to sell your advertisement to a second-tier advertiser at a lower rate. The solution is simple. You can run as many auctions as you want, as you can in the background. And once you get an advertisement from the ad network, you don't necessarily have to display advertisement. If you don't like the bids that you received from the ad network, just skip it, run another auction. So this is another thing that we implemented at Apodil. It actually allowed us to improve our earnings about 30%. And by the way, all the stuff that I'm sharing with you here, you don't necessarily have to use Apodil. You're more than welcome to implement it yourself and make sure that it works. All right, before I get to brands, let me give you a bit of comparison between CPM and CPI and why I believe CPI is not fair from publisher's point of view. So as many of you know, many ad networks, most of ad networks, they are CPI based. So they only pay to you when user when conversion occurs. You're not getting paid when you display an advertisement. You're not getting paid when users click advertisement. You only get paid when conversion occurs. But this is something that you cannot control. You cannot control as a publisher the quality of the of advertisements. You cannot control the quality of the landing page. You cannot control the quality of the tracking software they are using. So it is very common to display 10,000 impressions and not get a single penny for it. Now, why we all like brands as publishers is because publishers pay per impression. They don't really care much about conversion rate. They don't put all risk on publisher's side. This is why it is very important for pretty much everyone here who wants to squeeze higher ad networks, higher revenues from ad networks, to display more advertisements from brands. So anyone who cares about display making a transition from CPI towards CPM should ask yourself: do I collect enough data about my users? Do I know my users' age? Do I know their gender, their interests? So once you start collecting this data and start passing it to your advertising partners, you can actually expose a specific user segment to an advertiser. Because any brand, they want a specific user segment. Like, I want my advertisement to be seen by females of 25 living downtown San Francisco. And they actually pay much more than CPI. So the traditional approach is to use a DMP, a data management platform, which don't really work very well because it's not a first-hand data. It's not a first-hand data. They apply machine learning predictions and stuff, so the data is not very accurate. So very often brands can't really rely on it very much, especially in mobile, because in mobile, DMP is still very amateur. So first-hand data is much more valuable. If you start collecting data from within your app and pass it to advertisers, you will benefit a lot from it. And I will tell you two simple ways to collect data within your app. So first of all, is the usage of social networks. Think of any way you can integrate Facebook within your application and request the user permission to access their data, like age and gender. It can be literally anything, like competing with their friends or sharing something on Facebook. This is just a simple way you can, you know, start collecting data. Another option is rewarded surveys. If you don't want to deal with Facebook or you can't do it for some reason, there is always a way to implement a rewarded survey within your application and reward your users somehow for completing this survey, like giving him a premium status or some coins, like, right? So, yeah, of course, always make sure that you display a privacy alert that you collect all this data because you don't want to get in trouble because of that. So implementing one of the simple tricks would allow you to expose your inventory to brands and get paid much higher.
Excuse me, can I ask you a question?
First of all, what we do, we force ad networks to compete against each other, right? When you have an exclusive deal with a single ad network, they don't necessarily have to pay you as much money as you want because they're not in a position when they compete against other networks. Then, in comparison to traditional mediation solutions, we provide dynamic waterfall, which means that we automatically pull reports from all the ad networks and compare their performance, try to predict their performance in each country and in each application. That allows us to achieve maximum fill rate, maximum eCPM, and most important, maximum earnings. And there is no need to manually manage your waterfall. So there is no need to sign up on ad networks because this is not what publishers should do. Publishers should worry about developing a cool application, and someone else should take care about their monetization. So in this case, we set up accounts on all the best performing ad networks on your behalf and manage them in a way so that they yield maximum earnings to you. We also provide universal SDK that bundles SDK from all the ad networks, so you don't have to integrate all of them one by one. As I mentioned before, we pull reports from all the ad networks to predict the CPM that we might get from a specific ad network. We blacklist low-performing advertisers on a CPI ad networks. So as you know, many ad networks, they're CPI-based, and you're not getting paid because advertiser is not good enough. The quality of their creatives is not good enough. So we typically you would have to blacklist them manually. We do it automatically. We provide similar success to RTB exchanges and basically CPM campaigns. At this point, we are selling about 30% of our traffic through RTB exchanges. We are analyzing user behavior because some users, they never click a single banner, right? So it is better to display a CPM campaign to such users. Some other users, they always click any kind of banner, but they never install anything. they are the right target for CPC campaigns. And you know, some users are worthy to display CPI campaigns. And then we provide immediate payouts. So I hate when I have to wait for 30 days or even 60 days to receive my money from the ad network. So what we did, we provide an immediate upfront payout. Literally, you can get your payout on the very first day, and we support multiple payout channels like PayPal, wire transfers, Google Wallet, and Bitcoin, obviously. Second price auction, we mitigate second price auction, as I was telling you before. We provide you access to branding campaigns over RTB exchanges, and this is pretty much it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Does anyone have any questions? Yep, there you go, gentlemen in the front.
Use the mic, please. We're going to pass you the mic.
You made mention of DMPs being unreliable, but I find that that major brands generally require a DMP. They require some type of verification. It's not enough for you to say, I had a survey that occurred and it says this is a female interested in cars. In reality, they almost always require some type of third-party audit, almost. And so you get, for example, somebody like Universal McCann giving you a Scientology campaign, and they say, yeah, I'm glad that you think that they're from Germany, but send it over to our guys, and we'll tell you whether or not it's Germany. So I'm kind of interested in if you do have any type of high-level integration, or if you take care of that for us, you take care of meeting the campaign requirements beyond just a simple bid?
Yes, we do. We do take care of it. Basically, we're a little bit on the other side. We're on the publisher side, whether integrating with the DMP is traditionally a DSP side, a demand side platform side. So what you're saying is right. Having a DMP in place is better than not having anything at all. But as I mentioned, the market itself is amateur. So very often, DMPs they even can't provide enough data about your users. They don't know anything about your users. So I'm not saying that DMP is not worth it to use. I'm saying that there is a better way to use it, and you can expose additional user segments of your audience to your advertiser.
Anybody else? Yep, there you go.
This is awesome. As a publisher, I think this is great.
Thank
you. I'm just curious, like, though, I have to imagine, like, on the decoy bidding, is the IAB, like, cool with that? Or, like, I mean, have you gotten any friction? Is anybody sort of looking at that as sort of almost, dare I say, bidding fraud? Or, you know, where does that stand?
Now, this is completely compliant with pretty much every ad network. So we never do anything behind the scenes. Every ad network that where we implemented this feature, they are very well aware of that. And I mean, that's fine. That's just a price floor usage, right? There is nothing illegal here.
I think we might have room for one more question.
Just in the last thing you mentioned, did I understand you basically have a sort of a personal click-through rate for users and then target based on that? It sounds like you were describing something like that.
You mean user behavior analysis?
Clickers get CPC campaigns and non-clickers get CPI.
Yeah, so every device we measure an average CTR for them, and we measure an average conversion rate. So that allows to introduce weights for each device, and based on that we can decide whether we want to do CPM, CPI, or CPC. It typically allows you to serve advertisements more efficiently.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Pavel. Let's give him a big round of applause.